we'd see one, two, three, all ghosting along, and they were beautiful. Right from a very early age, I was aware of wherries, and I loved them.
The wherry was built to carry cargo from the coast to the village staithes on the Suffolk and Norfolk Broads. It uses no fuel, makes no noise, and carries 40 tons of freight. Last century, there were hundreds. Today, there is only one.
It's difficult to believe that it's the ancestor to the articulated lorry, these monsters that go around the roads these days. It'd be much better to do it that way. It's kept out of the way, anyway.
There is something very special about a black sail. I don't know what it is, I can't explain it. It's just something very special.
This is the story of how the wherry survived and of the people who saved her. The inspiration for her survival came, like the phoenix out of the ashes, on the Normandy battlefields on D-Day.
I was really shocked by the destruction, the fields with dead and dying cattle, the khaki figures huddled down beside them, which you knew would never rise again. I looked at all this destruction, and suddenly, right in front of me, by the sand dunes, was a dike. And in that dike was something very familiar, a patch of yellow irises, yellow flags we call them in Norfolk. And suddenly I thought, well, there are better things than this. When we get home, we'll see where all those ships have gone, those lovely wherries. I'd known them since a child, and I thought, well, if they've gone, if the war's destroyed them all, we'll set about saving one. And that really is what made me think that I could perhaps resurrect a wherry and set her sailing again, if they had all gone, but I didn't know whether they'd all gone by then.
They had nearly all gone, sunk to hold up the riverbanks. For 300 years, the waterways had been the arteries for freight transport. Their development can be traced from the Middle Ages, when Norwich was England's second city, until their heyday in the last century. Wherries were built for the rivers.
Yes, all right, it's all right. Just keep it coming, keep it coming, keep going.
To pass under bridges, the mast was balanced with a ton of metal so that it could be lowered and raised easily. The sail was soaked with fish oil and tar to protect it. And, filling most of the hull, was a huge open hold.
Wood would actually sit on the walkways, port and starboard, and they'd stack it up at least, 4 or 5 feet above the deck. With reed, is exactly the same, which could be a little bit higher, and on the deck as well. And then with sugar beet, which the sugar beet, if you're carrying 40 ton here, you'd sit, that'd be proud in the middle.
Sights like this were commonplace in Norfolk and Suffolk.
But I remember in 1928, most past my head, I'd been married a couple of years. I was all alone on a wherry, carrying sugar beet, up to Cantley. I used to do 2 a week, and I was working 7 days a week, 18 hours a day on average, and I think my money's about 4 something an hour, piecework.
But the river was being overtaken by the train. As the rail network spread, the wherry trade declined. By 1945, there were no wherries left under sail. Some survived, fitted with engines. When Roy Clark came back from the war, he gathered support and a meeting was arranged to discuss the preservation of a wherry.
Roy Clark put this letter in the press, and we had this meeting at the Stuart Hall, and Lady Mayo took the chair. And through Commons we got the offer of the Albion, and everybody, the majority of people, locally, Norfolk people, said, oh, they're mad, that'll never function, that'll never go, and that won't be any good, that won't do, we'll spend a lot of money which they hadn't got. And the only person who really backed us up greatly was Lady Mayo, who said, look, we've set this trust up to preserve a wherry, and we've got it, we will. And we kept going, and we're still going. And that was 50 years ago.
Lady Mayhew was part of the Coleman dynasty and regarded as Norfolk's first lady of sailing. Under her chairmanship, the Norfolk Wherry Trust was formed. Now restored, Albion is 100 years old. Lady Mayhew, also 100, was the guest of honour at Albion's centenary party.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the trustees and the committee of the Norfolk Wherry Trust, I welcome you all.
We saw a lot of people and said, look, we must raise money for this. And it's tremendously worthwhile because it's the last of any ship that we should be able to find. So we raised the money and bought her. Then we tried to find a home for her.
Over those years, a young historian was witnessing the end of the wherries.
We all ended here, really, because this used to be known as Hobo's Dock. J.S. Hobo was a dredging contractor who did a lot of work on the rivers, and he bought up all the old wherries and used them with his dredger. When they just got so rotten that they sank, he got paid for sinking them to hold the bank up. Oh, yes.
When Robert came here 50 years ago, he talked to the men who worked on the wherries. One of them is John Fox. He still lives on the site and remembers sinking the wrecks along the water's edge.
Because we walked down there, you can see the entrance. Let's go down this way, it'll be better to walk. You can see then, it'll give you a little idea. Because they used to buy the wherries to put the foot in the holes to fill them up. Well, you see the shape of the wherry, look, because she's laying there. Where's the snout? It's here, where you are. No, it's this way a bit more, I think. Let's have a look. You see the shape, Barbara? She's laying there. It had to be the dragon apple. There it is.
Yes.
That's the old Vega.
So that's where the mast used to be
that's
set.
That's it.
That's all there.
The Vega.
What was beyond her?
Caroline?
Yeah.
Jesse? The old Keel, what was her name? The old Keel, the Prince. That was an old Keel buried as well, wasn't
there?
It? Yeah. She lay on the back.
So all the 19th century wherries eventually landed, or a lot of them anyway, landed up here. And some were sunk in the dikes at the back of us. But that was how the commercial wherry trade finished.
One escaped Hobro's graveyard. The plane was being used as a floating warehouse by Coleman's, the mustard company. The Wherry Trust bought her. The original name of Albion was replaced and she was towed away.
To have got the Albion, or the plane as she was then, I thought was a great step forward. Then we could start working. And work, by Jove, we did work.
It was his life. He devoted everything to it, everything. He put 100%, and if you could put more, he put that in. Everything. I mean, absolutely, his whole life was restoring the Albion. The Albion will sail again. He didn't worry about anything. It was just the main reason was Albion was going to be rigged and sailed again and going to have a crew, and there was going to be a wherry trust, and then, of course, all the fundraising, things like that. And he put 100% into it, and it succeeded.
To save them from complete oblivion, the Norfolk Wherry Trust was formed. And on Thursday, the once derelict wherry Albion, rescued and refitted, made a ceremonial trip from Yarmouth to Norwich. At Hardley Cross, where responsibility for the waterway changes from the Yarmouth to the Norwich authorities, the Mayor of Yarmouth welcomed the Mayor of Norwich aboard.
In 1949, Albion was under sail again. For the first voyage in her new life, the Trust revived this ancient ceremony at Hardley Cross.
After this initial voyage, the Albion has to go to work in earnest, carrying cargoes which have been promised by local merchants, and teaching another generation.
The cargo has gone, but the ceremony is now established, and Albion is still carrying mayoral parties 50 years later.
Oh yay! Oh yay! Oh yay! If there be any manner of person that will absume, perfy, implead...
The event is purely ceremonial. But as long as it continues, it reminds today's sailors of the importance of the rivers.
The wealth and the history of Norfolk is based on trade on these rivers. Norfolk was wealthy in the medieval and later period because it had what was the motorway network of its day, these rivers. It could deliver produce from towns locally and get stuff out and round the coast down to London. That made Norfolk rich, so we should remember that.
You know, when you go to places like Rome and Venice, and you get a real feel of what went on there thousands of years ago, if not hundreds of years ago. And I think we've got a lot of history here, and we should make more of it, I think.
But the Albion wasn't preserved for pageants or picnics. The hold is big enough for a banquet, but it was built for freight, not fancy lunches. Wherries were serious trading boats. The Trust had originally restored Albion to carry cargo, and they needed an experienced wherryman.
Wherrying is a craft. Firstly, you've got to learn how to load her. Jack Cates loaded the Albion with deals, Norwegian deals. It came up through the hold, and he built it out about 6 feet over her right-ups. Now, only a wherryman could do that. A stevedore couldn't do it. Then you've got to learn how to quant. Then you've got to steer her. You don't just hold a little piece of mahogany and go like this, you know, with a... You have to get your backside against it, and you have to put your foot up against a cleat, and you have to heave with your whole body, especially when she's on a wind.
The wherryman's skills were passed down through the family. Kim Dowe is one of Albion's skippers. He learnt to sail with his father, but he doesn't consider himself to be a wherryman.
My father was a wherryman, not a skipper. There's two different things. He was a working man on a wherry. We do it for pleasure, and like we meet people, it's good. But in his days, that we work in nice conditions, but where he used to work in the frost and the snow and the ice and that sort of thing, where he used to carry like beet, reed, and it was hard work.
It was hard on the boat as well. Albion sank twice in 3 years, carrying 40 tons of sugar beet. This salvage operation cost £1,000, and the Trust decided that the risk of serious damage to Albion outweighed the benefits of keeping her trading.
We were trying to revive something for which there was no call. Wherries, like wherrymen, died out years ago, and really we were doing something quite artificial.
After about two and a half, 3 years, Jack came up to me and said, "Well, Jim," he said, "there ain't no good." He said, "We're not even getting enough to pay our wages." He said, "We can't keep a trading." So we gave up trading, and she laid it up for a time. Then we found there was a demand for her to be used, at least there was an opportunity to use her for taking pleasure parties if she was fitted with hammocks and things, as she has been done, and we've done that ever since.
Taking passengers on a wherry was not a new idea. Holidays on the Broads began long before the motor cruiser.
Well, it really goes back to the sort of middle, late last century when various Victorians who discovered the Broads either took pictures as Emerson did or wrote books or did both as Emerson did. And this inspired the Victorians to come and sort of discover this wonderful area and meet the natives who, if you talk to them nicely, were quite friendly and wouldn't sort of attack you and things like that. And go on these fantastic voyages of discovery where you could get lost and disappear into the mist and into a sort of sea of water lilies. I mean, they wrote very poetically and with full of flavour, but that created a demand. And people came to the Broads, and of course that there were not the boats available to take them out. So the idea of fitting out a trading wherry with cabins and taking people on board, giving them a holiday during the summer season, was a very attractive one.
This is the diary of a family holiday on the wherry Bertha. Bertha was built as a trading boat in 1890 to carry grain. A decade later, the grain went by train, and Bertha was converted to a pleasure wherry. The Broads and boats had found a new and more decorous living.
She was built for the Coleman family, as in Mustard, two Coleman sisters in particular, and she was built in memory of their younger brother, Alan Coleman, and he died on a boat out in Egypt in the 1890s, and that boat was called Hartle. And when they were having a wherry built, they decided to build it in memory of him, and so they decided to call it Hartle in memory of the boat out in Egypt. The pleasure wherry is based on the trading wherry. The hull of the pleasure wherry is exactly the same as a trading wherry, but it's fitted out with cabins instead of the hold for the cargo. The wherry yachts were the later development where people, at the turn of the century, when they were having holidays and didn't quite like the idea of going on a vessel that looked as if it could have been a working boat, they'd rather have a yachty type holiday. And so the wherry yacht was evolved. Had a yacht-shaped hull, painted white. The yachts at the turn of the century had a counter stern anyway, which was somewhere for the people to sit aft. So it was the same size as a wherry, but looked quite different.
There was a suggestion that Albion could be converted to a pleasure wherry, but that is not why the Trust preserved her. She was built and restored as a trading boat, although these days Albion only carries freight for reenactments and photo calls. Her usual cargo, too, is human.
Bring the tiller towards me a bit. Bring the tiller to starboard a wee bit.
Charters provide much-needed income for the Albion and a unique opportunity for learning.
I think it's really important for young people to have access to this. I mean, I'd like to see more young people having access to this, because there's so many groups of children, particularly in the city areas, that have got no idea that the Albion exists, and it will never have opportunities unless adults are proactive in ensuring they do get the opportunities to go out on the Broads and to be on something like this. And it's a fantastic experience. I mean, just sailing through the water, under full sail, and just slightly gliding through and sort of seeing all the wildlife and the, going past the mills and the ruins. I mean, it's just amazing.
This boat, you can actually imagine yourself on it years ago.
Yeah, it's like going back in time. You can imagine yourself sitting along here and all the wherries coming past, because there's supposed to be quite a lot of them in those days. It was about 260 or something. And we were quite lucky to have this experience. A lot of people have died to come to this.
They will have come away with a really strong sense of achievement, because they'll have been part of the crew that sails this sort of through the Broads. I think they'll find out more about Norfolk and the Broads, The list is endless, really. But I think they'll come away very positive and very happy. I know they will.
Free fall! On your head, girls, boys.
There's an opportunity here for children to go sailing. They can become mates, and they can could eventually then also become skippers. But we need to get them in on the ground floor. We need to educate them when they're at the school level, make them become members, and they can get benefits from becoming members. And then later on, they can become, hopefully, skippers. That is the future.
This is not the future. This is Albion's present maintenance shed. It's barely big enough for Albion's fittings, and it floods in high tides. The Trust is hoping to build a bigger workshop with dry storage and a visitor centre.
We need somewhere where people can come and look at the history of Albion and the Trust. We have kids also who come from schools, and we want them to be part of the experience. It is an experience. It is a unique thing to have a boat, really, which is 100 years old. So we need somewhere where these kids can come and sit down and learn, because we have so many awards so many prizes which are scattered around the countryside and locked up in people's garages. We need to display these things somewhere as well. We have archives. We've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of books which have been left to us.
For now, the archives will have to stay in boxes, stored in the loft with the Christmas decorations and cared for by wherry enthusiasts.
I was talking to my granny, and she told me my grandfather used to work on the wherries. So I decided I'd better go and see what these wherries were. And so I started to look at all different photographs of wherries, and any photograph I came across or any writing on wherries, I started to collect. The other people in the Trust then realised my interest in it and decided, well, you've met a good archivist because you've now started to find out where all the sources of the wherries are. And that's what I've been doing ever since. I only wish I'd have got involved a bit earlier because I could have spoke to a lot more people who knew about it then.
There is something enchanting about wherries. Whether it is that Victorian idea of wilderness or just the tall, cloaked grace of them, a wherry takes hold of your imagination.
My parents decided to holiday on the Broads, and I found it a wonderful area, and I was really taken by the windmills. In those times, there were wherries still about, but the Albion was sailing, but there were quite a few others as well, which were just travelling around under motor and still trading. And something sort of clicked.
20 years later, Vincent Pargeter returned with his wife to look for a wherry. It was not for a holiday. They went to the wherry graveyards and found a wreck which they hoped they could rebuild.
It was impossible to know because she was submerged.
Yeah,
wasn't
we really
she?
Had no idea at all. We just had to, had to be an act of faith, really. But we had heard that she'd been floated a few years before. I just felt that the job was sort of within my capabilities. Mind you, we started off with a five-year plan, and we've been going 18 years now, but that's the way these things develop.
I knew he was capable of it. I know his skill as a carpenter, so I really had no doubt that if he put his mind to a project, it might take a long time, but he would get there in the end.
We're in the forepeak of the vessel, which is right up in the bows, and we had to replace many of the timbers here. That is the apron and the stem post on the other side of it. We had to replace those, and we also had to replace all the frames of the vessel. That's these timbers here. There is one of these every 11 inches, and the boat is 60 feet long, so you can imagine how many there are. We haven't got as much originality as Albion because she's got all her original fittings, and we've lost all ours. We'll have to recreate those. I think she will add to people's appreciation of wherries.
The Pargeters have received grant aid from the Broads Authority. The authority is keen to promote the traditions of the Broads and helps all the wherries. But to keep Albion sailing requires dozens of volunteers, sponsorship, donations and patrons. The patronage is impeccable.
I was partially involved in starting a thing called the Maritime Trust, which was to try and preserve these historic ships of various kinds. And, well, I suppose the Norfolk Wherry was not perhaps one of the bigger ships, but it's certainly one of the important part in the maritime history. When you think that she was really the freight carrier for centuries.
The Duke of Edinburgh is the centenary patron for the Wherry Trust and enjoys being associated with the Albion.
I think that they deserve a lot of credit for what they've achieved. And I think if I can make them feel that it's all been worthwhile, so much the better.
A proud moment for the Trust's members. But Albion's maintenance bill matches her size. A new sail costs nearly £5,000, so is even royal patronage enough?
We need lots of people with lots of big bank balances to come along and give us money, it's as simple as that, to do these sort of things. Where otherwise, for the future, we've got nothing to hand down.
To survive another 100 years, the Albion must attract enough new members to the Trust. Once they join, the wherry spirit will never leave them. Roy Clark moved away from Norfolk and hasn't set foot on a wherry for 40 years. But Albion is still very much in his heart.
If I saw her again, I would like to be in the... at her tiller, I think. Not that I've got the strength to work her tiller now, but I would like to be up there with the after the game.
With good maintenance, good working people, there's no reason why she shouldn't survive another 100 years.
I'm rather pleased that 50 years afterwards, that little prank of ours has paid off and she's reaching her centenary, which is rather nice. Because, you know, when we got her, I wrote, well looked after, she might last for another 15 years. I wasn't a very good prophet, was I?